series of frequently asked questions. I'm Martin Bissett, and what we try and do in this series is we collate throughout the year all practitioners' questions from the accounting profession. The most common ones about fee growth, about marketing, about winning new work, about pricing, and all kinds of different things, and answer them for you as best as we can in 5 minutes. Today we've got one from Craig who asks, what is the best way to follow up a first meeting? Now, by first meeting, we're going to assume here that he means a first meeting with a potential client rather than anybody else, like a referral source, for example. And generally, when you have a first meeting, the natural thing to do is to shake the hand at the conclusion and say, thank you very much, I'll come back to you with this, or you'll come back to me with that, or you'll send me something, or I'll send you something, or we'll review it in a couple of weeks, or so on. And what happens is that if that prospect wanted to talk to you in the first place, and we'll assume that they did, and that you did a great job of finding out all about them, of establishing a relationship of trust with them and so forth, then there is no reason now to lose any impetus. We've created momentum with them. Allowing the meeting to drift from here is madness. So what do we do instead? Well, instead of saying, I'll email you, I'll call you, you call me, you email me, let's stay in control. And many practitioners avoid this scenario because to them that's a wee bit pushy or manipulative or cajoling or even bullying. But it doesn't have to be that way. Because let's take the scenario of a good first meeting. This has typically lasted maybe an hour, maybe 2 hours. Maybe you've been offered a tour of their premises. Maybe you've gone on to personal subjects and you've found common frames of reference or common interests, whatever it may be. If it is that they have been willing to talk to you, an accountant, for so long, bearing in mind that the highest likelihood is here that they already have an accountant, this demonstrates significant interest. Generally, business owners don't have a lot of time to waste. So if they don't have time to waste, they're not going to sit there with you for an hour or two chewing the fat for no good reason. So we've got to assume that we've done a good job in getting them interested in the possibility of working with us. So at this point, anything can happen once we leave the meeting. Once we're out of the door, crises can hit the business, their enthusiasm can wane, we can slip down the priority list, any number of different things. Therefore, we've got to negate the possibility of that working against us. And here's how we do that. In the initial meeting, okay, we'll come to a natural conclusion in the conversation where they'll say, okay, right, thanks. Well, thanks for coming in right now. And we'll say, it's a pleasure. And we stick and we get stuck, but we don't need to, okay? The way in which we can conclude it is to use effective language, such as, well, thank you very much indeed for taking the time to meet with me today. We've come across a number of points here that I think are worth exploring further. What I need to do is I need to go away and have a think about the most appropriate way forward now. Can I ask, you know, would it be possible for us to get together again in, I don't know, a week or so, something of that nature, okay? Now they might say, well, maybe just send me your thoughts and we'll take it from there. Okay, and so we'd fall down at that point, and that's where the process would stop, and we'd say, okay, we're going to have to send you a proposal now, and that would be an issue. So take it a step further, and we say, okay, can I ask you, apart from yourself, who else is involved in the decision-making process to appoint a new firm of accountants? And they may name their shareholders, they may name co-directors, they may name family members, and we'll say, okay, well, I need to put together my thoughts on how we can overcome these issues and take things forward. So when's the most appropriate time that we could get everyone together? To which they may respond, oh, it's going to be 3 weeks before that can happen, or it's going to be a month before that can happen, or so-and-so lives in Cuba. It's going to take them, you know, it's just not possible. So we need to look at when we can get as many, if not all, of the decision makers involved in the process around the table. And then we say, well, what I'd like to do is make sure everyone involved can get a real feel for what you and I have talked about today, and also give me an opportunity to explain where I think the most value lies in us working together, how we could go forward, and what that would take, and of course, what level of investment would be required. So you said it would take about 3 weeks to get everyone together? Oh yeah, I think at least 3 weeks. Okay, well, that gives me long enough to be able to formulate my proposal and make sure it's ready to present. So 3 weeks from now is the 28th of the month. Why don't we have a look at the 29th? How's your diary set for the 29th? Do you have the diary on you? I have it on my computer here. Let me have a look. And we start to now formulate the dates. And say, well, yeah, I could do the 29th, but not until at least 1 o'clock. You would have your diary on your device of some kind, and you'd say, okay, well, 2:30? Yeah, let's go with 2:30. Great, well, what I'll do, we'll set that up for the 29th at 2:30. That gives me time to prepare everything I need to. Hopefully it gives you time to get everyone around the table and au fait with what happened in the first meeting. I'll obviously confirm that formally in between times. But what I'll do is I'll go away, put together what I think is the most powerful solution, come back, discuss it with you. That gives everyone the chance to ask all kinds of questions. We'll resolve concerns, any issues, inquiries that may come up, and reach a conclusion one way or the other, depending on how everyone feels. Would that be okay? Generally, your answer is that would be fine. Because if you've created an interest in that first meeting, then there is no other response other than, yes, that's what we'd like to do next. It's a natural progression that we go through to a further discussion where something more concrete would be discussed, including the price. So remember, the key steps that we need here are, number one, a very gentle, relaxed approach. Number two, we need to dictate what's going to happen next, as in the next meeting, but they're going to dictate to us when it's going to happen. Well, we can't do that for another 3 weeks yet. No problem, 3 weeks from now is. We need to make sure that happens. And we need to set the agenda and the conclusion that we want from that meeting ahead of time. So what I'll do is I'll put together a proposal, we'll present that to everyone around the table, we'll talk through all the issues, and then we can reach a conclusion one way or the other. So they know what this next meeting is for. And there's no reason why they should not reach a conclusion for you at that time. So, Craig, the question of what's the best way to follow up the first meeting is to, in summary, never leave the initial meeting without the date in the diary for the next meeting. If you find tremendous pushback from them on not wishing to have another meeting, that should be a red flag to you immediately that something has gone wrong and you haven't created enough interest or enough potential value to talk to you again. So assuming you have, there should be no objection to the next meeting, and that's the best way to follow up the first meeting. So I hope you found that useful, and I look forward to seeing you in the next Frequently Asked Questions. Bye for now.